So earlier I asked some questions in the video. So first was, what is the source with maximum turbidity? So the answer for that is river. And why river? Because the water in river is constantly flowing, and because of that, if you remember from irrigation or water resources engineering, it has some silt carrying capacity, or it carries some silt always. I mean, the silt is always there in suspension. Whereas if you talk about other sources like wells, open well, and if I say lakes also, so in these cases the water is still. That is, even if some particles are there initially, they will settle down. But in case of river, some silt is always there in suspension. Because of this reason, the turbidity will be maximum in rivers. And another question was the relationship between electrical conductivity and total dissolved solid. So obviously, as the total dissolved solids increases, electrical conductivity also increases, because the ions which are there in water, they will increase with increase in total dissolved solids. So these were the two questions I asked. Now after that, let's move to the next chemical property or next chemical parameter, that is alkalinity. So alkalinity, if we talk about the definition, so it is defined as the capacity or the ability of ions to neutralize the hydrogen ions that are present in water. A hydrogen ion will be there due to some acids, so it is the ability of ions to neutralize the acids present in water. So that is for the definition. And the major sources due to which alkalinity happens or it occurs are carbonate ion and hydroxyl ion, as well as this bicarbonate ion. So the corresponding alkalinity we define as, if it is due to carbonate ion, we'll say it as carbonate alkalinity. If it is due to hydroxyl ion, then it is called as the caustic alkalinity. Turbidity due to this bicarbonate ion is called as bicarbonate alkalinity. And the reason or the source for these carbonate or bicarbonate, it basically occurs due to some reasons. That is, if minerals are present in water, then it becomes alkaline, or due to atmospheric CO2, it can become alkaline, or if algae is present in water, then also it becomes alkaline. And the reactions that take place during this, so first, if we say the carbon dioxide is added to water and we get this reaction which goes in both the directions, and it converts into carbonic acid. Now this breaks into H plus and bicarbonate ion, that is HCO3 minus, and this HCO3 minus further breaks into H plus and CO3 2 minus, that is your carbonate alkalinity, this is your bicarbonate alkalinity. And last reaction that can take place is this carbonate ion will react with water to give the HCO3 minus plus OH minus. That is your caustic alkalinity. Now this last reaction, it happens at high pH or if algae is present. Otherwise it is a very weak reaction, and if algae is present, then it consumes all of this bicarbonate ion. So at high pH, this bicarbonate ion will not be existing, does not exist. Only this hydroxyl ion exists. So we say that this bicarbonate ion and hydroxyl ion cannot, it is an assumption that these both cannot exist together in water. With this assumption only, we go further for calculation of this alkalinity. Now, these all the reactions take place in this order, that is here for this last reaction pH will be maximum, that is like 10 to 11 and above, and in this if we go in the upward direction then the pH decreases for all these reactions. And this bicarbonate alkalinity, it gets over or it is consumed at a pH of 4.5, and if pH is further decreased then this converts into carbonic acid. So if what is the problem, first of all, if alkalinity is present in water then the taste becomes bitter, so not a large amount of alkalinity should be there. And one more thing is there, if these carbonate ions are there, and so these are free to react with calcium ions, so because of that we will get a precipitate of calcium carbonate, and because of this precipitate incrustation of pipe happens, so that's why it should be avoided. And after that, to understand this, how we go for the measurement of alkalinity, alkalinity is measured with the help of titration, and we do the titration with 0.02 and H2SO4, and it is expressed in terms of calcium carbonate equivalent. So this we'll understand in some time. First let's see what we are doing here. We are adding the acid, that means we are providing hydrogen ions. So these hydrogen ions will be reacting with the alkalinity causing ions. So first of all they react with the hydroxide ions, that is the reaction H plus and OH minus, so we will get H2O. Then they react with the carbonate ion, so we get the bicarbonate ion here, and finally they react with these bicarbonate ions and we get the carbonic acid, that is H2CO3. So as we are adding or we are increasing the amount of hydrogen ions available with the increase of this acid, so what will happen, the pH will go down. So we have some basic relationships between the pH and what are the ions that will be available at that pH. So this pH is measured with the indicators. So for higher pH, that for 8.3 and above, we use phenolphthalein indicator, and for lower pH, for this 4.5, we use methyl orange. Now as the pH is, as we are adding these hydrogen ions or as we are adding these acid, so as the pH reaches 8.3, so it has been observed that all the hydroxide ions and half of these carbonate ions are neutralized with the help of this hydrogen. Why only half of the carbonate ion? Because first of all these carbonate ion convert into bicarbonate ion, and then further acid is required. So let's we assume that half of the carbonate ion is neutralized at the pH of 8.3. So here we say that at pH of 8.3 these two have been neutralized, and as we further add the acid, the pH will be coming down. So at a pH of 4.5, it is seen that the remaining half of carbonate ions and all the bicarbonate ions that were there, they are neutralized. So the amount of acid that is required from initial to this pH of 4.5, that gives you total alkalinity. So let's say initial pH was 10, for example, and we reduce the pH to 4.5, and we in this process we use 30 ml of acid. Then 30 ml of acid represents the total alkalinity. We convert this 30 ml of acid to CaCO3 equivalent, that we'll see with the example, but this will represent your total alkalinity. So that is about it. So let's say at pH 8.3, the amount of titrant or ml of titrant which has been used is and at pH of 4.5 it is M, that is your total amount of titrant that is used. Then if P is equal to M, that is P is the total volume of titrant, then the alkalinity whatever was there, it was there only due to this hydroxide ions, and we call this as caustic alkalinity. And if this P is equal to M by 2, then the alkalinity whatever is there due to only carbonate ions. And if P is less than M by 2, then we say this alkalinity is there predominantly due to carbonate and bicarbonate. And if it is greater than M by 2, then this alkalinity is there predominantly due to carbonate and hydroxide ions. So that is easy to understand. If P is greater than M by 2, that means this point we are reaching somewhere here. So obviously these two ions are more. If P is less than M by 2, if P is below this half of the total value, then this bicarbonate ions and carbonate ions are predominant. So similarly other two also you can understand. And after that we will see how do we do the measurement. That is, as I said, we use 0.02 and H2SO4. So let's understand this in detail. So why we are using this particular titrant for the titration here with the concentration 0.02 N? So for that there is a reason. That is, if you use this titrant, then 1 ml of H2SO4 will neutralize 1 milligram of alkalinity expressed as CaCO3. So that is, if we can find out the amount of this acid, we can directly link it with the alkalinity. That's why we prefer using this acid. So for understanding something more, we have to go to the basics. So first of all, understand, let's see what is the normal solution. So normal solution means you take 1 gram equivalent of something and you put it in 1 liter of solvent. So solvent, let's say water is there, so you mix it in 1 liter of water, that will make you 1 N solution. Now what is 1 gram equivalent? So 1 gram equivalent, to define gram equivalent, it is equal to weight in grams divided by equivalent weight. Now you will say, what is equivalent weight? So equivalent weight is equal to molecular weight divided by its valency. And molecular weight is the weight of 1 mole of molecules for that particular compound or element. So let's see, for example, let's say for CaCO3, what will be its molecular weight? So molecular weight would be the summation of molecular weights of all these elements. So for calcium, molecular weight is 40, for carbon it is 12, and for 3 oxygen it will be 16 into 3, that is 48. So that is equal to 100. That is 100 grams is its molecular weight. Now what is the equivalent weight? So equivalent weight is equal to molecular weight, that is 100 gram here, and its valency. So if we are talking about the ionic compounds, so valency is defined by this ionic charge here. So for this it is 2, so that is 50 gram is your equivalent weight. Now if you want to know about the gram equivalent, so gram equivalent will be equal to, let's say for that we'll have to take some quantity. So let's say we have taken 100 grams of CaCO3, then gram equivalent is equal to 100 100 divided by its equivalent weight. So what is its equivalent weight? It is 50. That is, we have made 2 gram equivalent of CaCO3. Now to understand, so there is one more thing, that 1 gram equivalent of one element or ion, gram equivalent of something, reacts with 1 gram equivalent of other thing. Let's say, for example, so let's say CaOH hold twice. So if we understand them as ions, so we have Ca2 plus and 2OH minus. That means we'll have to take 1 mole of this ion, calcium ion, and we'll have to take 2 moles of these hydroxide ions. Then only then this reaction will be balanced. Now understand it with the gram equivalent. So let's make 1 gram equivalent of each. So that is, for calcium, what will be gram equivalent for 1 gram equivalent? So the weight, molecular weight, is 40, and its equivalent weight is 20, because 40 by 2 is 20. So if we take 40 grams of calcium, then we'll get 2 gram equivalent. So for 1 gram equivalent, we'll have to take 20 grams of calcium. So 20 by 20 will give us 1 gram equivalent. Now let's make gram equivalent of this hydroxide ion. So that is, its molecular weight is 17 and its equivalent weight is also 17. So if we have taken 17 gram of OH minus, it will make us 1 gram equivalent. Now if you see here, that is, if we are taking 17 gram of this hydroxide ions, that means we have taken 1 mole of hydroxide ions. And here, as I said, here we need, if we are taking 1 mole of calcium, then we need 2 mole of hydroxide ions. And if we are taking 1 mole of hydroxide ion and 1 mole of this calcium ion, then this reaction cannot take place, because twice the hydroxide ions are required. So for that, if we are taking 1 gram equivalent, because in 1 gram equivalent we are taking 40 by 2, that is your half mole. So half mole can react with 1 mole. So that is what is meant by here. So that is, in half mole we are making 1 gram equivalent. Here also, in 1 mole we are making 1 gram equivalent. So we say that 1 gram equivalent of something will react with 1 gram equivalent of other. So let me try to explain it once more. Let's say we have taken Na plus and OH minus. So here 1 mole of each is required. 1 mole of Na will react with 1 mole of OH minus. So let's make gram equivalent. So for Na, the weight will take 23 grams and divided by its equivalent weight. So that is also 23, because valency is 1. For both valency is 1. So that is, for 23 grams we are making 1 gram equivalent. And in 23 grams we'll get 1 mole also. Now let's see for OH minus ion. So if we take 17 gram of OH minus ions, so that is weight in gram divided by its equivalent weight. So equivalent weight is also 17. So that is making 1 gram equivalent. Now we are taking 1 mole of both. That's why this reaction is possible. If we, let's say, you take, instead of 17, you have taken 34 grams of OH minus. So what we'll get? We'll get 2 gram equivalent. Now can this reaction take place? Because we have 2 moles here. 2 moles of OH minus ions. So 2 moles cannot react with 1 mole of sodium ion. So that way this reaction cannot take place. So 1 gram equivalent of something reacts with 1 gram equivalent of other thing. I hope this is clear to you. If it is not, please let me know. I will try to explain it again. So our normality was gram equivalent divided by the volume of solvent. That was our normality. So with this logic, we can say that 1 gram equivalent of H2SO4 will be equal to 1 gram equivalent of CaCO3. It means that if we divide it by, or if we multiply it by 0.02 by 1000, just to make the solution, this is for 1000 ml. So 0.02 by 1000 gram equivalent of H2SO4 is equal to 0.02 by 1000 gram equivalent of CaCO3. So this is for 1000 ml. So we can say that 1 ml of 0.02 and H2SO4, if we are talking in terms of 1 ml instead of 1000 ml. So here it will be equal to 0.02 by 1000 gram equivalent. So first of all, let's say what is the amount of calcium carbonate in 1 gram equivalent. That will be equal to, so what is the equivalent weight? We have to take same amount equal to equivalent weight. So Ca is 40 plus this carbon is 12 plus 48 for oxygen, and valency is 2. So that is 50 we'll get here. So we have to take 50 grams. So that will make your 1 gram equivalent. So 1 gram equivalent is made of 50 grams. That means 0.02 by 1000 gram equivalent will be made of 0.02 by 1000 into 50 grams. And that is equal to 1 by 1000 gram, or we can say 1 milligram. And that's what we said earlier, that if we use this titrant, then 1 ml of this titrant, 1 ml of 0.02 and H2SO4 represents 1 milligram of alkalinity expressed as CaCO3. So that's how we calculate it. So we'll understand it further using example.